will be required to evacuate the building immediately using the nearest fire exit. Lay down identified at the rear of the room. Designated staff will help you evacuate. Your fire assembly point is situated at the rear of the building. Thank you. Councillors, ladies and gentlemen, please go standing.
Thank you. Please be seated.
Good evening, Lord Mayor. Good evening, members. Can I advise members that apologies for absence have been received from Councillors Daniel Barrington, Tim Beaumont, Peter Brown, Calvert, Nick Crofts, Andrew Foxley, Ian Francis, Roy Gladden, Ros Gladden, Claire Blair, Sue Heron, Steve Mumby, Pauline Walton and Jeremy Wolfson. Are there any further apologies, please?
Councillor Kevin Morrison's had some minor surgery, so...
Thank you.
Good evening, everyone. Can I remind those present that this is a meeting held in public and not a public meeting? I would also like to emphasise that this is a key public meeting. Can I therefore request that everyone present, including the public, treat this meeting accordingly, which will enable the business to be dealt with effectively. The use of social media and filming for reporting proceedings is permitted during council meetings. This does not extend to filming of members of the public, and anyone wishing to film the proceedings are also particularly directed to be very sensitive to the issue of filming children without the express permission of their parents. And also, for members of information, the BBC will be filming the proceedings, particularly in relation to item 8 on the agenda. Can I also advise members of the recent marriage of Councillor Andrew Foxley, and to extend to him and his wife its best wishes for the future. That is great. Chief Executive.
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Declarations of interest. Can I remind members that you are only required to declare at meetings any disclosable, pecuniary or prejudicial interests, in which case the member will need to leave the chamber during the consideration of that item. Are there any such declarations, please?
Are the minutes of the extraordinary City Council meeting and the City Council meeting held on the 22nd of July 2015? Agreed.
Question time and petitions and statements, Lord Mayor. Can I advise the Council, as a statement has been received from representatives from RNIB in relation to item 30 on the agenda.
Could I invite Lindsay Armstrong and Louise Dwyer to address the Council, please?
That's in relation to a motion which is being put to the meeting later on about a street charter. RNIB LRB did a survey last year where they received over 500 responses from blind and partially sighted people. Just to give some headline figures on that, 95% of the respondents said that they'd collided with an obstacle in the previous 3 months, and a third of them had been injured. Other issues that were raised in the report were concerns about shared space and surface schemes. This report was about the national situation rather than specifically locally. In relation to shared space and surfaces, key issues were about things such as the removal of curbs, crossing from tactile paving, and introduction of non-segregated cycle lanes. These can cause difficulties for blind and partially sighted people in terms of navigating and crossing roads safely, because a lot of these kind of schemes where crossings are removed rely on eye contact between drivers and pedestrians, which is difficult for people, many people who are blind or partially sighted. The report also contains information about accessible crossings, which I'll touch on later, and the key obstacles which you referred to are things such as bins, cars parked on pavements, overhanging foliage, and street furniture and advertising boards. The report can be read on the RNIB website, but it does, just to give some brief examples, it contains examples such as people tripping on A boards and having sprained wrists or nasty injuries, for example, from upturned legs of the A boards. RNIB have had some local input on this. Members of the public have complained about some issues such as tripping over A boards and inaccessible crossings in some areas, not fully accessible crossings rather, some that don't have audio input. There are sometimes reasons why there can't be audio input, but generally speaking, tactile audio input is important. So basically, what are we asking for? We're asking for the local authorities to enter into street charter in discussion with blind and partially sighted people. There is a street charter document on the RNIB website which basically sets out potential action points. There is a lot of flexibility to take account of the local situation, such as the local geography, basically things that are already happening, identifying and continuing good practice, along with identifying gaps and priorities. The sort of actions that would be considered would be things like reviewing council policies on the key areas, you know, such as obstacles, crossings, shared space, which would cover issues such as things like maintenance of crossings and monitoring and reporting problems. Also it would cover issues such as consulting and involvement of blind and partially sighted people in planned developments and street audits of the existing situation, accessible consultation materials and methods, and raising awareness of issues with amongst decision makers, contractors, developers and such. Also, an effective enforcement of relevant council policies. So just to emphasise, this would build on existing good practice as well as identifying gaps and priorities. We hope that you'll be able to support the motion later.
Mayor Anderson, would you like to respond?
Just very briefly, Lord Mayor, just to say thank you for bringing it to our attention. Clearly, we've got a debate taking place later on. Congratulate Councillor Anna Key for bringing it again to the Council's attention. I don't think anybody really agrees with it or not support it, so I can assure you that it will get Council's full support.
Thank you. Item 4, Mayor Anderson.
Lord Mayor, thank you for that. There's a few announcements that I do want to make, Lord Mayor, but I think it's also important, not because Councillor Kent put this on his blog asking me for responses, but I talked to the Council, as I have done today, to members of the public and to audiences about the £90,000 that was paid in relation to costs for the council's legal action. It's important, I think, that people actually get an opportunity to hear the full facts and also to understand the complexities of this and the reasons why certain things were done. I've certainly got nothing to hide or wish to disclose, not disclose, everything should be open and transparent. So that's why I was on the radio today, did an interview with the local press and beforehand talking about the reason why. Now, I need to go back to a few years when I was leading the opposition of the council. And I know I've mentioned this to some of my groups at a group meeting, so apologies for repeating it, but it's really for the people to understand. When I was leader of the opposition, Sefton Council used to pay the then LEA-controlled Chesterfield High School around about £7,000 a year. Now that £7,000 a year was to pay for the 208 hours that I was allowed off from the local government act. It actually cost around about less than £4,000. But Chesterfield High School used to get £7,000. So the school had a good deal out of the decision. And people can talk to Sefton Council about that and check with Sefton Council that that is actually the case. It was no dissimilar to what used to happen for local authority leaders, not just here in Liverpool, but around the country. For instance, the leader of the council prior to me, Councillor Bradley, was allowed time off, and his time off was covered under the local government rule for 208 hours. And any cover that was needed for him being off was paid out of the public purse. Thousands and thousands of councillors across the country do it. And if you look at the one before him, Councillor Storey, Knowsley used to pay somewhere around about £40,000 to the school, the plantation school, for a supply cover. But Councillor Storey, who don't forget was part-time, not full-time, and that was paid, and this council used to reimburse them back. So you can see that not only were them two former leaders of the council, but Sefton Council leader Peter Dowd, who used to work for Liverpool City Council and was the leader of Sefton Council, again used to get paid that money and it was covered. The chair of the Police Authority, former councillor, which is now deceased, Carol Staffson, and many others received that amount. So you can say to yourself, well, that's right, because it's a public service that people are carrying out and they should be able to do that, and it's enshrined in the Local Government Act. So what happened with regards to myself? Well, when I then became leader of the council in 2010, people in the Labour Party certainly know that I made a pledge and a promise that I would become a full-time leader of the council. That for too long, this council was run like a toy town council. That officers led the councillors by the nose, councillors who weren't here, and decisions were made that were quite frankly not good enough for a council and a city like Liverpool. And it needed to be done differently and changed, and we did that. And we promised that the council would be led full time. Now for 2 years, the arrangement that Sefton used to have with Chesterfield High School continued. They were paid the £7,000 and I received the 208 hours prepaid. What I did with that money is a different matter, but people can check on that and see the charity where that went. But that's another matter and a personal matter. But the reality is that arrangement was there, it was transparent, it was open, people could have asked of Sefton, but it was no more than what everybody else was able to do across the country. The difference, however, came in the negotiations that we had for the mayor. Now, Councillor Kemp, with his little book of victory, he talks about us forcing that through, me forcing that through, and when I earn enough. All of the things you know about, I'll talk about his LGA funds in America and what we've got now and the thousands that we've got. We'll talk about all of that. I'll concentrate on me and when he says, did I get them off it? At no time did I ever become mayor of this city for me. I did it because it was the right thing to do for this city. But whether we like it or whether we don't, the city decided through a vote of this council to accept the city deal and a mayoral model. What would you do? 6 weeks, 7 weeks before my 55th birthday, Sefton School, Chesterfield High School, became an academy. 6, 7 weeks before my birthday, sacked me. Without any discussion with me, without any negotiation with me, without any conversation with me. P45 in the post, you're sacked. Now, for me, the fundamental principle of that, as a trade unionist, I would support any councillor of whatever political party they may be, green, red, blue, yellow, any. The principle of someone being sacked for carrying out public service should be something that we all defend and stand by. The council, in its decision, asked the questions about of the school because they needed to know, well, what is it you've done here? What is it you're doing? And again, they were smeared that public money was used to ask these questions. The council was right to ask the question because it was about the governance of the city. They asked simply those questions. Then it was decided that it should be challenged and the indemnity policy should be used. Now that decision was taken by the chief executive, the city solicitor, and it was run past the district auditor, and it was run independently past legal advisers who said, yes, it's the right thing to do, because it's not about Joe Anderson, it's about the mayor of the city. It's about the governance arrangements that you have in place, and it is about the mayor of the city. And that's the reason why that decision was taken. The chief executive and the city solicitor are already answering questions and will continue to do so. Then we ask ourselves the question around the politics of this and where it's getting played out and how it's disgracefully being played out. Of course, Councillor Kemp says, will he pay it back? Councillor Kemp asked any of his past leaders to pay the indemnity money back. Any one of them. Any one of the half dozen that received it. Did he ask for them? Coincidentally, some of them were found to be responsible for their own actions and guilty. They're not wrong. They're absolutely not wrong. The only thing I've done wrong was trusted the school to honour that procedure that we got in place, which was costing them nothing. But because it went to an academy, they decided to sack me. That was the only thing that we did wrong. And then you ask yourself the question, has Councillor Anderson benefited from this? Has he gained from this? Well, let me tell you, not only have I not gained, my good name, which I'm proud of, and the hard work that I do for this city, has been sullied by individuals in this council, dragged through the mud by individuals in this council for doing nothing more than trying to save the people of this city. It's been estimated that because I've been finished in my local government pension that I had for 16 years, that I will have lost somewhere estimated to be £134,000 in contributions. If I die now in service or whatever, I'm not in service, of course, because I'm not in the pension. My wife, my family, I get nothing, no protection, no job to go back to. And yet there's councillors in this chamber who want to play politics with that. One thing I can say, and in all honesty, that if any councillor in this chamber or any other chamber is sacked for doing public service. Joe Anderson will be the first one to actually get up and support them. Support them, whether they're governors, whether they're magistrates, or whatever, because it's the right thing to do, public service. And so my conscience on this matter is absolutely 110% clear. Because nothing I've done in this matter was for Joe Anderson. Nothing. The priorities for me was getting the best deal for the city of Liverpool, for its people. That's why we built new schools. That's why we're building houses. That's why we've got the Mayor Investment Fund and creating those things. It never, or did I ever at any time, see any personal gain for me. And not one single person from the opposition have actually ever asked Joe, how did you get on? What did you lose as a result of this? Because they played dirty politics with it. And that shows to me the contempt that they have, the contempt they have for the democratic politics that we've engaged in over the Mayor's deal, and also the disrespect that they have for this city and for us and the formal governance that we've got. So let me just say, finally, on the matter of the indemnity. The fact of the matter is, and it is a fact, that the government have now accepted and are saying that they will change through legislation the changes that need to be made to support mayors in the future as they go forward. The fact is, if I had stayed as leader of the council, not only would I have been able to, and again part-time, retain my salary and retain my allowances, I would have retained my pension too. City wouldn't have had the mayor deal, wouldn't have had the schools, and wouldn't have had that investment, and I wouldn't have lost out on my pension accrued, and I wouldn't have lost out on the benefits that I would get if I was still part of the pension scheme. But let me just repeat, my conscience on this matter is absolutely clear. I'll move on now to a little report to let people know some of the facts. I'll move on to some other things that are in the
public. Hello there. Opposition councillors were named as smearing the mayor. I have never smeared the mayor on this count, and I'd ask them to retract that statement because I do take offence at it. I've asked questions to the chief executive to find facts which I haven't been replied to yet, but I really do take exception. Being called opposition councillors.
Well, I will withdraw that if you find it offensive, but what I find offensive
is
that, what I find offensive is the fact that you haven't come to me and asked me directly to answer some questions.
Well, to the chief executive.
Can I
ask some questions on the statement?
No.
Because you asked us. No, the mayor.
No, Councillor Radford, I'm asking you, we're not going to take questions on this item. No,
all
we're
right.
not.
Oh, well,
no.
I've just been told I should ask
Stop.
The mayor. So
we're not going to take questions. The mayor's made a statement. It's quite clear. Everybody in the council chamber understood what was said, and we're going to move
I
on
know
now.
What was said, but not the questions.
Mayor
the
Anderson,
mayor has said he wants us to ask him questions.
If you want an apology. I've just said to you, if you feel offended by what I said, that's fine. I feel offended the fact that you didn't ask me those questions. So
we're not, Councillor Radford, we're not going to continue this discussion. We're going to move on. Mayor Anderson, could you please move on, please?
Well,
thank you.
Some of the things in the press that clearly need a response from me. We're debating and discussing the issue of the asylum seekers that are, if you like, our call for the government to do more. But it's important, just for the sake of clarity around that, that we get an understanding before even we go into the debate, because you know some people actually don't understand the full complexity and entirety of what we do as a city. We actually support 1,800 asylum seekers in our city. It costs us a huge amount of money, around about £1.7 million a year. So we have to make sure that if we are taking asylum seekers, and I'll say more in the debate, it's important before anybody starts making contributions to that debate that they fully understand that particular number. And I'll say more and discuss it more, because our city will do as much as we do now, probably more than any other city or any other town within this country. So we'll talk more as it comes to that motion. Another exciting thing that's happening this week, Lord Mayor, it's important really to actually talk about. So tomorrow sees the official opening of the exhibition centre here in Liverpool. And what a massive boost to the economy of Liverpool. We've already seen the arena and convention centre generate, since 2008, over £1 billion to the local economy here in the city. And we look forward to opening that facility tomorrow. And I urge you to go and see it, because you'll be absolutely amazed by it. Seeing the new hotel next to it, and also then to understand, you understand the contribution that it will make and why it was the right decision of this council to invest in a new facility next door, so that we can compete with the Birminghams, the Manchesters and Europe in terms of attracting some of the best and biggest exhibitions. Also, last week we announced the, if you like, the great deal that we've done, and Wendy and the team, culture team, and myself working for months behind the scenes to bring the British Music experience to our city. A fantastic asset for our city, bringing in tourists and people to our city. Again, alongside in the Cunard building will be a restaurant on the other side that opens. I just want to take councillors on this side of the chamber back 12 months and remind me of our old mate there, Richard, one of the Kemp twins, saying that it was a waste of public money and that it was something we shouldn't do, he said. Well, the building is now way near 50% more than it was when we bought it. That's the valuation, which is great news, because the asset that we've invested in has gone up, and the money that we paid in terms of for it, that's protected and it's gone up. But we're now bringing in £1.2 million rent. £1.2 million rent. We haven't finished yet. But £1.2 million rent to support the services that we need to bring in the city. And I remember some of them here, and we're reminded, of course, continually, about the condemnation of that deal and what a bad deal it was for the city. And then, of course, you remember Finch Farm? Finch Farm, remember the other deal? Finch Farm, again, attacking me for doing that. £800,000 we now get in rent. So there's £2 million a year we're bringing in rent. Fantastic news for the city. But also populating the pierhead, populating our World Heritage Site, and bringing more tourists to our city. What a fantastic achievement, and this council deserves credit for it. And the reality is, there'll be more of that to come, because that's exactly what we do. We lead and we show the way. So, you know, that Cunard building deal is fantastic, a brilliant deal, and we'll continue to remind people. And because, you know, when we look at the things that we're doing, and somebody said to me around fighting the cuts, and I was listening to one of our councillors tell people, I think it was Peter, around every single day we fight the cuts by saving libraries, saving children's centres, investing and doing things differently to bring in more revenue and bring in more money. The homes we've built and the refurbished properties are now going to be around about £3.7 million. All great news for this city. Announcements that you should be proud of. Announcements that we will let the city know about. Not the negative stuff, like, you know, we've seen a leaflet today from the Liberal Democrats, two of them, in James Ward, talking about Caldy's Park being sold. Yeah. They talk about the railway, the model railway. Guys happy to move and get a new facility. Caldy kids happy to move and get a new facility. Beatsley Ride the stables. It's interesting that Councillor Eric is on the management committee of that, so she needs to decide whether she's for it or against it. Because there's new facilities going to be built.
That's incorrect.
New facility, where she used to be.
She wasn't on the management committee. She was now, no.
Well, that's what I said, so she was. Then you've never been. But you spoke for them and represented them, you know.
Chair of the ward, of course we were.
There you go. Well, yeah, well, both of you have to decide whether you want the new investment, because we've got the management committee who are delighted. And we've got the two ward councillors who don't want it. On the guys that they want to try and smear and lie and tell people, like we're closing the library in their ward, Allen Library, and now they're telling people that we're going to. So while all
point of order, my lord mayor.
Liberal Democrat liars.
On a point of order, my lord
mayor. Mayor Anderson, could you just say that for a moment?
I don't know the number, but with the chief executive confirmed, what he told us at the last meeting, that when a member is defamed, even under this part of the agenda,
I'm fairly sure that appealing to your common sense as the chief executive, but what I said is Liberal Democrat lies, didn't mean I said Liberal Dem lies. My understanding of the law is that I'm entitled to say that. I haven't
said
that.
Gross
cowardice. It's not gross
cowardice. Can I, Mayor Anderson, could I just ask that we do have a bit of order in the chamber, that obviously these are important discussions
and
debates and updates.
They are love me, and they are important updates, because they actually show how the city is doing well and the things that we're doing, like for instance that piece of land that's being sold is used to invest in new facilities. That's a new way of doing things, Lord Mayor, and I've just explained how we've done that in Powell, how we've done that with Finch Farm, how we've done that with Cunard, and how we're doing that with that particular piece of land. Investing in new facilities for people would generate a new income tax for us, new council tax that helps us to protect those services. That's the explanation, Lord Mayor. And I'm pointing out that some people, in leaflets, scared of people, are against that. I don't think there's anything wrong with explaining that, Lord Mayor. So I'll continue to do that, whether it's now or at any other opportunity. But just finally, because it's winding people up, it's good to see. The reality is that there will be, of course, more of the same. Proud of what we've done, proud of what we've delivered, proud of what we've delivered, with more to come. So that's the promise. Proposals and delivery of projects and schemes that benefit our city, and more to come, despite the smears.
Okay, thank you. Item 5, Councillor Dean.
Lord Mayor, can I know if the appointments of outside bodies is attached in those appendix B be approved? Can I move the constitutional issues that the appointments of the independent panel confirmed?
That agreed?
And can I remind colleagues or advise colleagues to change the name of adult social, adult children's social care, which is also in the notes?
Can I remind members, in terms of the timings of speeches, the mover of the motion gets 5 minutes and has the right of reply 5 minutes. All of the speakers, 3 minutes, and the 2 minutes extension if agreed by the council. But we'll move on now to item 7, rights and responsibilities regarding public march by Mayor Anderson.
Okay, Lord Mayor, I hope this will be brief, because I hope that the majority of people within the council agreed with the comments that have been made by me in the motion. And so I really just want to say a couple of words. I've said that at public meetings, but also to the press and to people, that nobody in this chamber, or I wouldn't support anybody that was against the right of freedom of speech. It's an important constitutional, fundamental platform of democracy, the right to freedom of speech. However, there has to be responsibility that comes with that. It is as simple as that. You cannot call freedom of speech the right to insult somebody, to threaten somebody, condemn somebody, and frighten somebody. And that's what's happened. I received dozens of contacts from BME members in Liverpool who said to me they were scared, they were frightened. And that's where we have to stand up. And the absurd position is that we have an organisation that can threaten to be here, and the Greens talk about the police needing to make that assessment. You know, again, they live in a world that's abstract, if you like, from the realities of what we have to do and don't understand what we have to do. The fact is the police have to come to me. They then present a case to me where they feel there is a threat. Then we have to go to the Home Secretary and ask the Home Secretary, I do, for the ability to ban that particular march. Yes, they do have the right to say you have to go in certain areas, but they don't have the power to stop anybody turning up at our city, in our city, at any time, and marching in any place in our city. They don't have that power. They simply don't. And for me, I think it's fundamentally wrong that happens, and it's cost this city literally tens of thousands of pounds in cost, because people have turned up, threatened to turn up, and then on Facebook and other social media saying they're coming again, and using language that's abhorrent to every person in this city, to most every person in this city. So my call for the Home Secretary and for you to support and back is that we reverse that. That we say we should have the right, if they are using that type of language and that is what they call white man marching. Its name alone should send shivers up people's spine. White man marching. The clue is in the title. The fact of the matter is, I don't want white man marching in my city, saying the things that they're saying. And neither do the vast majority of people in the city. And to add insult to injury, we then have to pay for it. So the reality is, it should be reversed. It should be the other way round. It simply should be for us to say, no, we don't think that you're going to support us in our beliefs around community cohesion, about being a diverse city, a proud city, a multicultural city. You're not in favour of what we believe in as a city. So take your spiel, take your bile, take your rhetoric, take your vile comments to another city, but don't come here. Now, if they want an appeal, that's great. That's fine. Let them appeal. Let them appeal through a process that takes them time, and then the Home Secretary has to make that decision. But we should be able to make the decision about what happens on the streets, which we were elected to by the people to represent them. And that is fundamentally what's being asked for within the motion, and I hope everybody supports it.
We have notice of an amendment by Councillor Radford.
Motion amendment. Amendment to propose.
Is the amendment seconded? So that falls. There's also a second amendment by Councillor Tom Crowe. Is that seconded? Okay. Would you like to speak on that now?
Thank you, Lord Mayor. Before I speak to the amendment, I'd just like to congratulate the Labour Party on the election of their new leader. Jeremy Corbyn seems to be a principled and popular man.
So
I hope he will be an ally advancing progression.
amend, but going back to the amendment, I mean, it's really hard to disagree with most of what the Mayor just said. And I know that this motion has been tabled with the best of intentions at its heart. The prospect of racist folks demonstrating in our streets is pretty disturbing, and we'd all like to stop it happening, and we'd all do anything to stop that kind of ideology gaining a foothold or gaining popularity in our city. And I think this debate, it is incredibly finely balanced, and I hope the discussion that follows about this amendment does respect that we all abhor this kind of greed, and you know, acknowledges that the discussion here is about just a slightly different way of approaching how we tackle this kind of issue. So just a few points on why we put this amendment. The principle of free speech, we need to make sure we're giving adequate weight and support. We need to protect people's rights to freedom of expression and freedom of assembly. And these aren't just inventions of the PC Brigade, these are enshrined in the European Convention on Human Rights. And human rights apply to everybody, even if we disagree with them. Secondly, history shows us that suppressing offensive ideas isn't the best way of getting rid of them. These ideas need to be debated in the open, and the vast majority of people will rightly turn away from them when they are in discussion. Thirdly, who decides what's offensive? If we start bringing in this kind of law, which allows city leaders to ban marches, how can we be sure that it will never be misused in the future to prevent people with a good cause marching? And I think there are some practical reasons why it's not really necessary as well. The police do have powers to stop marching and also to curtail them. They've done a great job of monitoring and handling marches in the city today. And people do complain about the cost of policing, and it's a fair complaint. But I would argue that this is just the cost of living in an open and democratic society. Another practical reason for there not being a need for this motion is the amazing response of civil society organisations and members of the public who organise the opposition to this march. Most people showed their distaste for the group partially outnumbered the handful of National Action supporters who attended the march. And this shows that we've already got the right approach, and that is having a generally well-informed population who feel that they are empowered to stand up and say what they believe in. So we should all agree on the fundamentals, that we all value tolerance, diversity and solidarity. Let's not erode freedom as a response to the bigotry of a tiny minority.
Councillor Kemp, are you speaking to the amendment?
I'm speaking to the amendment, but I'll make my comments generally, so I only speak once, my Lord Mayor. I too would like to thank the Labour Party for electing Jeremy Corbyn last week, but probably for very different reasons than those given by Councillor Crowe. My Lord Mayor, there are three issues here that we have to address, and I will be voting against the amendment today, as will Councillor Erica Kemp, who is not my twin. She's actually much younger, of course, than I am. And we will be doing so because we believe that the amendment is, in a way, too fussy. It's not that we disagree with it in principle, but what the Mayor has laid down is a very clear principle and a very clear way forward. And we believe that it is better just to have clarity on this issue. There are those who think that we are attacking free speech by even contemplating a resolution of this sort. Quite the opposite. I believe that this is our way of defending free speech. If a citizen wants to put a view, whether I agree with it or not, if he does it or she does it,